Hello, I'm Morton Blackwell, president of the Leadership Institute, an educational foundation with a mission to identify, recruit, train, and place conservatives in politics, government, and the media. My staff and I have put this video together to explain in detail how socialism, the ideology of the ultra-left, has evolved over time from a voluntary experiment to, at its worst, a coercive form of government that strips people of the rights and liberties that we as Americans enjoy every day. Many well-meaning people are ensnared today because the ultra-left, socialist at its base, is active in so wide a variety of causes. It's time for all serious people to study and understand the ultra-left because, despite many setbacks, they still have many skills and they still aspire to power. Sometimes, for tactical reasons, they conceal what they think and what they want. Often, though, they write or say what they really think and really want. And sometimes those thoughts appear in what they write and say in public. This presentation will reveal, not always in their own words or in thoughts they would admit, 35 things the ultra-left really thinks. Then we'll present, documented in the left's own words, what leftists actually have said and written on these 35 topics. Finally, for each of the 35 points, we'll give you contrasting opinions by people who believe in limited government, free enterprise, a strong and independent America, and traditional moral values.
Let's begin with a story about a place that changed history forever, a place where the ideals of America's founding fathers were finally buried, and a new political order was born. A place where mankind touched heaven and became divine. Well, that was the idea, anyway. Welcome to New Harmony, Indiana. In this small town is preserved a lesson for the ages. Here, nearly 200 years ago, a community of German colonists built a thriving frontier town. The soil was good. Harvests were large. Craftsmen sold their wares as far away as Philadelphia, New York, and New Orleans. When the colonists decided to move on, they sought a buyer for the town of New Harmony, and they found this man, Robert Owen, a British industrialist, social reformer, and prophet. Mr. Owen had a vision, and he'd come to America to make it a reality. And so he bought the thriving town of New Harmony, lock, stock, and barrel.
I am come to this country to introduce an entire new state of society, to change it from the ignorant, selfish system to an enlightened social system which shall gradually unite all interests into one and remove all cause for contest between individuals.
Owen the prophet sounded the call. Settlers were needed for a great new experiment. Mr. Owen had a word for it, socialism. Private property, he said, must be eliminated forever. Religion must be wiped from the earth, and the traditional social order, marriage, education, entertainment, morality, it all had to be turned upside down.
Man, up to this hour, has been, in all parts of the earth, a slave to a trinity of the most monstrous evils that could be combined to inflict mental and physical evil upon his whole race: private or individual property, absurd and irrational systems of religion, and marriage.
In 1825, 1,000 eager believers joined Owen in New Harmony, vowing to build the new socialist order. Intellectuals and celebrities of the day rushed to heap praise on Owen and his merry band. Newspapers across the world ran fanciful accounts of the experiment. Educators and social reformers came to lend their talents. Then the cheers died down, and the newspapers moved on to the next story. And New Harmony, well, New Harmony slid into comic ruin. It took just 2 years for socialism to turn this thriving town into a basket case. But if you think that Robert Owen learned a lesson from his experiment, you don't know socialists. Back in Britain, Owen built a church of socialism. He appointed bishops of socialism. He wrote hymns to socialism. And socialism became the fastest growing and most destructive religion in all of human history. Like many religions before it, socialism splintered, then splintered again. Democratic socialism, syndicalism, national socialism, international socialism, Arab socialism, communism. By 1970, more than half of the world's population lived under one socialist regime or another. And in almost all cases, that meant repression, poverty, and woe. Today, citizens of those nations are eagerly embracing economic, political, and social freedom, rejecting the socialist faith they had been fed as a religion. The final tally? Socialist regimes have killed about 150 million people in the past century. They've impoverished billions. Socialism has destroyed the traditional social fabric of countries as divergent as Russia, China, and Kenya. So have socialists finally learned from their mistakes? If you think so, well, you don't know socialists. 200 years ago, across the Indiana frontier, the former colonists had thrived. With good soil, broad rivers, and plenty of land, you almost had to try to fail. But fail, the socialists did. Robert Owen set out to prove that private property was the root of great evil. His New Harmony settlers learned otherwise. Without the motivation of private reward, everyone fought for the easy jobs. No one could be bothered to break his back in the fields. Young men drank and made merry. Crops went unplanted. Fences were never repaired. The New Harmony residents formed committees to study the problems, but never found the energy to solve them. In the end, they became beggars, pressuring Robert Owen for loans to keep the colony afloat. The complete failure of New Harmony and similar experiments in voluntary socialism persuaded most leftists forever that they had to use coercion, government force, and even terror to achieve their socialist dreams. Voluntary socialism didn't work, and coercive utopians have dominated the left ever since. Now, let's explore in detail the roots of the ultra-left. What they really think. Around the world, there's been ample evidence. Free enterprise means prosperity, and free enterprise is driven by the possibility of profit. Just don't try to explain that to the young and dumb at a leftist rally.
Profit comes from evil greed.
That's bullshit! Get off it! The enemy is profit!
Disease and starvation
will not be solved by corporations!
That's bullshit! Get off it!
The enemy is profit!
Stop having these excessive profits where people are, you know, worth $900 million or they're billionaires. When you have people who are starving on the streets, these are the workers in these corporations and they're just stealing wealth from them. We say these extreme profits are well stolen from the workers.
Helen Caldicott stated, "Free enterprise really means rich people get richer. They have the freedom to exploit and psychologically rape their fellow human beings in the process. Capitalism is destroying the earth."
Conservatives disagree. Here's what free market economics professor Dr. Walter Williams says.
The role of profits in a free society is to guide resources to their most efficient use. That is, companies that are successful, companies that make profits. And they, number one, they make a good that consumers enjoy. And number two, they produce it in the most efficient manner.
Greed is part of the human condition. It's some people have greed or envy. The question is what you do about it. If somebody wants to have more money and he works on Saturday, that's good. If somebody wants to have more money and he robs banks or becomes a bureaucrat and raises taxes, that's bad. The one is voluntary and it's called capitalism and free market, and the other is not voluntary and it's either called theft or government.
Fear not, say socialists. We'll take the wheel of the economy. Profits know nothing. We know what's best.
Socialists must get all your property!
We're anti-capitalist, and we have lost faith with both the Democrats and the Republicans. To us, they're virtually indistinguishable. We're a Marxist party and Leninist, and we believe that socialism is the only sane alternative to capitalism, which f***s everybody. Socialism would be a system by which there would be shared abundance. There would be cooperation, not competition.
The People's Tribune reported, the same extraordinary technology which results in layoffs and misery when used by the capitalist class could end poverty if placed in the hands of a society reorganized along cooperative lines. Peter Burrell stated, we reject the idea of private property. Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels wrote, abolition of property in land and application of all rents of land to public purposes.
When the government seizes all property, properties are generally put to lower value uses. That is, when there is a market that decides who gets what, then property is put to high valued uses. And if you look at, you know, many people trust government. Now, if you look at the areas of our lives, you ask the average human being in our country, what areas are you least satisfied with? He'll say, well, schools, police services, the post office. Those are the activities run by government. What areas of the life are you the most satisfied with? He'll say computers, supermarkets, video stores. And those are areas that are run by the free market, by capitalist incentives, by people motivated by greed. In the Soviet Union, so far as the agricultural sector, the Soviet Union allowed their farmers to have a tiny plot behind their house where they can grow their own vegetables. And these plots consisted of 1% of the Soviet farmland, but nonetheless they produced over 30% of the agriculture output, which shows you that even in a communist country where when they resort to private property and markets, you find success.
Frederick Bastiat wrote, see if the law takes from some persons what belongs to them and gives it to other persons to whom it doesn't belong. See if the law benefits one citizen at the expense of another by doing what the citizen himself cannot do without committing a crime. Then abolish that law without delay. F.A. Hayek said, the system of private property is the most important guarantee of freedom, not only for those who own property, but scarcely less for those who do not. Barry Goldwater said, a government that is big enough to give you all you want is big enough to take it all away.
Don't want to sign up for the socialist new experiment? Tough. Meet your new friend, the taxman. To the ultra-left, socialist and progressive mean exactly the same thing. Bill Clinton said, we could give it all back to you and hope you spend it right. But Hillary Clinton said, many of you are well off enough that the tax cuts may have helped you. We're saying that for America to get back on track, we're probably going to cut that short and not give it to you. We're going to take things away from you on behalf of the common good.
In an environment where we've seen the creation of 1.5 million new jobs since last fall, driven by President Bush's policies in cutting taxes not once but twice since coming into office, that many of the beneficiaries of that expanding economy would nonetheless like to raise taxes and wish that prosperity away for their own political gain. The truth is that as the tide rises, all boats are lifted, the large and the small, the left and the right. And I think Americans would do well to look at those that want to, in effect, derail our economic expansion for their own short-term political goals.
The tax man cometh, and the tax man taketh away. On and on it goes. But don't ask too many questions or look for any relief.
For big government, no new tax cuts.
Hillary Clinton said, this whole budget and tax cut plan puts politics first and people last. We're in for a fight. I intend to be on the front lines in that fight. Senator Ted Kennedy said, keep your tax-cutting, greedy hands off our Medicare. Howard Dean said, The president's tax cuts are part of a master strategy to starve the core programs that have shaped our country's safety net.
Politicians of both parties resist tax cuts. When President John F. Kennedy proposed cutting the top U.S. federal income tax rate from a staggering 91%, many Republicans opposed the cut, making themselves tax collectors for the welfare state.
We've seen what happens when you increase taxes. The capital gains tax was doubled in 1969 under Nixon, and we had the stagflation of the 70s. We saw marginal tax rates cut from 75% to 25%. We had the Roaring Twenties. Those tax rates were then raised to 75% under Hoover, and we had the Great Depression. When tax rates were cut across the board under Kennedy, we had the growth of the 60s. When taxes were increased under Nixon and Johnson, both income taxes and capital gains taxes, we had the economic slowdown of the 70s. When Reagan cut taxes, we had the growth of the 80s.
I feel like we've just played the World Series of tax reform, and the American people won.
When Bush raised taxes, we had an economic slowdown until the Republicans took the Congress and cut the capital gains tax. Then you had strong economic growth again. When you cut marginal tax rates, you have more job creation and more wealth creation. When you raise marginal tax rates, you have less.
Government can create wealth, say socialists, but around the world, socialism has meant economic backwardness and poverty. But who are you going to believe, a well-meaning socialist or your lying eyes?
Only government creates wealth!
Peter Levine wrote, "Government creates wealth by providing necessary public goods, such as universal education, research, and transportation. Moreover, maximizing aggregate wealth doesn't always help most people." Al Sharpton said, "We are investing in the wrong people in the country. We are investing in the rich rather than investing in working class families, giving them productive and constructive jobs."
The government cannot create wealth. The government cannot create jobs. Government can only take things that other people create and give them to other people, usually holding on to a rather significant handling fee.
I think one of the things you have to recognize is that government has no resources of its very own. And moreover, there's no tooth fairy or Santa Claus that gives the government resources.
When people say the government just did something, what they really mean is the government took money, time, from other people who earned it and gave it to someone who didn't earn it.
For your shopping! Bombs are dropping! For your shopping!
On a spring day in Washington, D.C., in comfortable clothes and well-fed, it's easy to sing the praises of socialism. Its ideology bankrupt, socialism looks more like a snake with a broken back, wounded but dangerous. But the utopian ideas still inspire some, and the days of old can still be glimpsed.
We believe in the original ideas what the Soviet Union is founded upon, are Marxist and Lenin.
The glorifying of mob violence, the appeal to rage and embitterment. Here, as in the past, the most radical are cheered. The more moderate ignored. On the fringes, those eager for meaning in life become the pawns of the more radical who set the standards of behavior. And with the fall of the Berlin Wall and the Soviet Union, a new generation is growing up without real-world examples of socialism to judge. So what about those socialist states of the past? Russians suffered through 75 years of socialism. Government controlled every financial decision in the land. Russia's reward, a timeless joke. We pretend to work, they pretend to pay us.
Bureaucrats spend your money better than you do.
Multinational corporations, the domination of corporate capital, has more power around the world, certainly, and even in the United States, and they have since the robber baron period. And I think that's really eroded democracy, and it's really led to, you know, this massive increase in inequality. And having an economic system that's based on prioritizing, you know, the maximization of profit instead of meeting human needs and ecological wisdom and all these sorts of things, building a more democratic and humane society. That's one of the fundamental things.
Robert Kuttner wrote, "Public investment can also keep the economy at full employment, which in turn strengthens the bargaining power of all workers." We could tax some of that private wealth and use social investment to create decent jobs that would serve a much broader range of human needs, jobs in teaching, healthcare, child development, and other high-quality public services. Jerome Christensen wrote, "The fact is, government, all government, spends our money better than we do." Ralph Nader stated, "You burn yourselves out doing charitable work, but if you get into politics and get to the cause of these problems, you will have a just society where you don't need so much charitable work."
From the pharaohs to medieval kings, the elites with power have always felt that they could spend the wealth of a nation better than the peasants or the farmers or the working men and women. And today's bureaucrats and politicians are just like the pharaohs. They'd rather have pyramids, whereas the people might prefer to have bread.
Margaret Thatcher said, "They have the usual socialist disease. They have run out of other people's money."
Social unrest in 1930s Germany brought Adolf Hitler and his National Socialist Party, the Nazis, to power. Then socialists drove Germany down the road of national suicide.
Norman Mailer wrote, "The function of socialism is to raise suffering to a higher level."
There's a truism that I think the left ignores, and that is that bureaucrats are people too. That the same motivations that a person has to build a corporation or build an enterprise, large or small, is the same set of motivations that people bring into public service. The whole school of public choice economics and Buchanan thinking brought the idea that just because someone works for the government doesn't mean that they aren't interested in expanding their territory and expanding their sphere of influence. When that happens in the private sector, that creates jobs. When it happens in government, it creates government. And that's the reason why many of us believe that strictly enforcing the principles of limited government and channeling people's entrepreneurial efforts into the private sector is the best for the Commonwealth.
India embraced socialism for the first four decades of its independence. The result? Armies of bureaucrats, mountains of red tape, and not a productive industry in the land. Like in other parts of the Third World, socialism became an excuse, allowing those in power to loot society.
Government jobs good, private employers bad.
Congressman Dennis Kucinich said, "My belief is that the government must be the employer of last resort when the private sector doesn't provide jobs. That's essential." American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, be it further resolved that the International and affiliates use every opportunity to deliver to decision makers and the public the message that privatization cannot provide high-quality, accountable public service. The Nation reported, "Instead of whipping poor people at the bottom, the government should act as employer of last resort, a form of safety net that would serve as an economic stabilizer in bad times, then recedes in good times."
People in the private sector create jobs, create wealth, and do things to please other people. The monopoly that is the government does things that don't please people, does things that people didn't ask for or don't want, and frequently destroys jobs and wealth.
You look at the public education establishment, they're government jobs. Now they've been producing decade after decade of failure, and they still have their jobs, and they earn higher money as a result of it. Now, that could not happen in private industry, where they're producing decades and decades of failure and dissatisfying consumers, they'd be fired. And so for incompetency, for incompetent people, people who don't want accountability standards, yes, a government job is a wonderful job.
It's a fiction that operating by force is somehow more noble than operating through voluntary exchange.
Cicero wrote, "A bureaucrat is the most despicable of men. I have yet to meet a bureaucrat who was not petty, dull, almost witless, crafty, or stupid, an oppressor or a thief, a holder of little authority in which he delights, as a boy delights in possessing a vicious dog. Who can trust such creatures?" Ronald Reagan said, "Government does not produce revenue, it consumes it."
A great teacher, great leader, great commander, and great helmsman, Chairman Mao, is the red sun in our hearts.
Chairman Mao conquered China for the socialist camp with promises of happiness and abundance for all. The masses cheered him on.
This is a victory of Mao Zedong's thought and the victory of the general line. Shout aloud with fervent emotion. Sing aloud with fervent emotion.
But abundance was not their reward. Poverty, famine, and 65 million deaths came instead.
Something for nothing fools almost everyone.
First of all, take all of the money from the military and from Iraq and put it back into health services, education, all the things this country needs. Their priorities are completely upside down, we feel. The people at the bottom are the ones being squeezed out.
Norman Thomas wrote, "The American people will never knowingly adopt socialism, but under the name liberalism, they will adopt every fragment of the socialist program. Until one day, America will be a socialist nation without knowing how it happened." Ralph Nader said, "These people up in Canada stumbled onto something 30 years ago. It's called a universal human right, healthcare, and preventive health as well. If they can do it 30 years ago, we can do it now."
That is what the left does. They offer free stuff, which is why I get nervous about Republicans offering free stuff, because if it's a fight over which party is going to provide more free stuff, the Democrats are going to win. Our argument has to be there's no such thing as free stuff.
Thomas Sowell wrote, "Socialism in general has a record of failure so blatant that only an intellectual could ignore or evade it." Benjamin Franklin wrote, "When the people find they can vote themselves money, that will herald the end of the republic."
And France, dear, dear France, constantly abusing themselves with socialism. The French have had a quasi-socialist state for the past half century. Businesses and families pay some of the highest taxes in the world. National debt and overextended social programs threaten to bankrupt the nation, all while an army of the unemployed and unwilling to work pay for their wine and cheese with ever more generous welfare checks.
Tracy Fernie said, "Enough is enough. We are sick and tired of politicians who steal from the poor in order to protect tax breaks for the rich. We are sick and tired of a heartless, cruel governor attacking those of us with the least. Instead of cutting from our needed health care and services, Pawlenty and Company should tax the rich. We say undo the cuts to poor and working Minnesotans. Make those with the most ability to pay the most."
For many years, conservatives said that welfare encouraged people not to work, and the Democrats said that's nonsense. When, under Republican leadership, we reduced welfare and reformed the welfare system and required people to go out and work, we dropped in half the number of people locked into welfare dependency.
The welfare state is really nothing but legalized theft. That is, the government taking the rightful property of one American and giving it to another American to whom it does not belong. Now, if I did that privately, we'd all agree that it's theft. And there's no difference whether an act is still theft, whether it's done privately or collectively.
For 60 years under the federal welfare schemes, tens of millions of Americans had their lives blighted by a government program that the liberals told us was helping them. So we know what welfare does. It destroys lives and destroys opportunities.
But after 200 years of socialism, out of hundreds of socialist experiments, after failures big and small, peaceful and violent, funny and sad, you will always hear one thing at the next socialist rally.
Socialism has never been tried!
Muammar Gaddafi said, "Socialism is not dead. It is not yet born." Vladimir Lenin wrote, "We cannot outline socialism. What socialism will look like when it takes on its final form, we do not know and cannot say." World Socialist Movement European Election Manifesto. Socialism has not been tried.
Asian, Latino, black and white,
workers of the world unite!
Socialism has never been tried? Yeah, sure. What about Robert Owen and the early utopian socialists? They tried it. What about international socialist Vladimir Lenin? He tried it. What about National Socialist Adolf Hitler? He tried it and killed more than 20 million people. What about International Socialist Joseph Stalin? He tried it and the Soviet Empire killed almost 62 million people. And of course, Saddam Hussein, dictator from what he called the Arab Bath Socialist Party. He ran a socialist government, looted his country, and killed tens of thousands of Iraqi citizens and others with poison gas, bullets in the head, or elaborate torture.
First and foremost, I would like to point out that what I mean by a powerful Iraq is an Iraq based on the Arab Socialist Ba'ath Party.
We don't have to guess what socialism and big government look like. It's the difference between East Germany and West Germany. It's the difference between North Korea and South Korea.
The 20th century is littered, the 19th century to a much less extent because they were more modest experiments. The 20th century is littered with the corpses of failed socialist experiments. Private property is the foundation of liberty. Without private property, there is no liberty.
Robert Owen did not like traditional religion, and so the Stone Church in New Harmony was converted into a common hall. Colonists would eat together, sleep together, sing together, work together, raise their children together, and eventually they would create a new man, human beings who never thought of themselves, only of the group. It was the cult of the common good, and it all rested on a very shaky foundation, the denial of human nature. It didn't take long for that foundation to collapse. Freedom from traditional morality didn't beget virtue and peace. It unleashed the darker side of man, jealousy, envy, sloth, lust, deception, greed. It was Robert Owen's second great mistake. Human beings are not pieces of clay to be molded into perfect social beings.
The misanthropic nihilism continued for a century and a half. In the 1950s and 1960s, college professors were still rejecting the notion of human nature. Herbert Marcuse, socialist champion of the hippie movement, was calling for the annihilation of traditional morality.
Traditional morality is always bad.
I'm part of the House of the Goddess, which is a pagan center for pagan women. It started in Tidewater, Virginia 9 years ago. It's now down in Tidewater, Virginia and in New York City. And I'm an anarcho-feminist, dianic witch. I worship the goddess. I support choice for all women, and I'm very political.
Michael Swift wrote, "We shall sodomize your sons, emblems of your feeble masculinity, your shallow dreams and vulgar lies. We shall seduce them in your schools, youth groups, movie theater bathrooms, wherever men are men together. Your sons will become our minions and do our bidding. They will be recast in our image. They will come to crave and adore us." Karl Marx wrote, "Religion is the opiate of the masses." Larry Flint said, "The church has had its hand on our crotch for 2,000 years, and the government is seemingly moving into that direction. They feel that if they can control your pleasure centers, they can control you. I happen to feel pornography is the most pure form of art." Dr. G.B. Chisholm wrote, "For many generations, we have bowed our necks to the yoke of the conviction of sin. We have swallowed all manner of poisonous certainties fed us by our parents, our Sunday and day school teachers, our politicians, our priests, our newspapers, and others with a vested interest in controlling us."
The left is about changing the world, redeeming the world. I mean, they think of themselves as social redeemers, which is a religious idea. And it's why they're so unbelievably and insufferably arrogant and self-righteous, because they are saving the world from us. They are the army of the saints. We are the party of Satan. And that's exactly the way they see it.
The wisest man who ever lived, Solomon, said, under divine inspiration, that living by God's principles promotes a nation to greatness. Violating those principles brings a nation to shame. Recklessness, situational ethics, the kind of behavior that knows no authority. It is the kind of thing that we are experiencing at a very low level in our nation today and must run from it.
I can't believe that a parent would want their son to go on overnight campouts, some as long as 3 weeks, with a person that they know is a homosexual. The Boy Scouts of America is an institution, and if the wrong people can tear down the right institutions, your society deteriorates.
Irving Kristol referred to the liberal agenda as moral anarchy and economic collectivism, and I think that's true. Sector after sector of the American culture has been corrupted by liberal beliefs and liberal nostrums, and by liberal control of the media, the universities, and now the judiciary.
Marx actually quoted in one of his tracts, quoted Mephistopheles from Goethe's Faust, saying, "Everything that exists deserves to perish." That's the radical creed. So they have no respect for anything.
F.A. Hayek wrote, "Socialists assume that since people had been able to generate some system of rules coordinating their efforts, they must also be able to design an even better and more gratifying system. But if humankind owes its very existence to one particular rule-guided form of conduct of proven effectiveness, it simply does not have the option of choosing another merely for the sake of the apparent pleasantness of its immediately visible effects. The dispute between the market order and socialism is no less than a matter of survival. To follow socialist morality would destroy much of present humankind and impoverish much of the rest."
Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. No regrets, no consequences. It's what the left wanted to believe and what socialists told them they could have.
Do what feels good now. Make taxpayers pay the bill.
Free abortion on demand. Free abortion on demand.
Sybil Shepherd said, "Our government should provide poor women with access-free abortion on demand, free birth control, free morning after pills."
We need to look no further than the current outbreak of sexually transmitted diseases, the violence in our culture, the addiction in our culture, addiction to chemical dependencies, to gambling, to sexual addiction, et cetera, all tell us that there are consequences for our behavior. And God was correct when he said, "Whatsoever a man or woman soweth, that shall he or she also reap."
Peace and understanding.
Leave your bourgeois family behind. Join us in a new world of peace and brotherhood. We're all brothers now.
Break all family ties.
Dr. Mary Jo Bain wrote, "In order to raise children with equality, we must take them away from families and communally raise them." A Journal of Female Liberation. "The nuclear family must be destroyed, and people must find better ways of living together. Families have supported oppression by separating people into small, isolated units, unable to join together to fight for common interests." Germaine Greer wrote, "Women's liberation, if it abolishes the patriarchal family, will abolish a necessary substructure of the authoritarian state. And once that withers away, Marx will have come true willy-nilly. So let's get on with it."
Whether we're talking about same-sex marriages or polygamous arrangements or group raising of children, etc., all the tests, all the examinations have been done by the religious and the non-religious culture indicate that God's idea of Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve, is by far still the best and only way to raise children.
If you think everything exists deserves to perish, and the future is the only reality, that's leftists live in the future, they don't live in the present, then, you know, anybody who's familiar with their own family, let alone any other, knows there are all problems. So let's solve the problems by abolishing the family. That's their solution to everything.
The Chinese government took it one step further. In order to augment the workforce, the communist government implemented a policy called fenpei, separating men from their wives by hundreds of miles for months on end, all in the name of the common good.
This policy that the Chinese government was implementing separated a husband from a wife. Wife had to work here, a husband had to work here, and we're not talking about just on another part of town. We're talking about miles and miles apart. Obviously, the family unit is best when the family unit is together. The Chinese government was putting its own economic interest ahead of the interest of the family, of a cohesive family unit. That's a violation of basic human rights, no matter where you're from in the country. And I think anyone in the world, any government in the world, ought to be appalled and ought to stand up to the Chinese government on these types of anti-family policies.
Ronald Reagan said, "When the liberals say family, they mean Big Brother in Washington. When we say family, we mean honor thy father and mother."
Forget the God of your fathers. We've got new astral planes to explore, new consciousness to celebrate.
Make God illegal!
John Dunphy wrote, "The classroom must and will become an arena of conflict between the old and the new, the rotting corpse of Christianity, together with all its adjacent evils and misery, and the new faith of humanism." Peter Singer said, "Christianity is our foe. If animal rights is to succeed, we must destroy the Judeo-Christian religious tradition." Robert Owen wrote, "There is no sacrifice which I would not have willingly and joyously made to terminate the existence of religion on earth."
Robert Owens, of course, lived, I believe, before Nietzsche and before the his infamous pronouncement that God is dead. But yes, the attack on God is the attack on the notion that we're fallen beings and corrupt in our nature and dangerous.
Without God and without laws and guidelines to live by, without the church, society would be in total chaos. There would be no order. There would be no civility. It would just be total destruction.
Our early history is ubiquitous with examples showing this. In 1775, the First Continental Congress called for a national day of prayer. In 1863, Abraham Lincoln called for such a day. In 1952, Congress established a day of prayer, and in 1954 added the words "under God" to the Pledge of Allegiance. The bottom line, this is a nation under God. And the quicker we understand that, and the longer we adhere to it, the more blessed we'll be.
They have tried every way they can think of to sneak in the back through that act and this law and that. They're trying to turn the clock back. They want women barefoot and pregnant and in the home.
Sexism, scream feminists. Who said women should be nurturing? Why does the man have to bring home the bacon? We must explode our ideas of man and woman.
Masculine is bad. Feminine is also bad.
Andrea Dworkin wrote, "Only when manhood is dead, and it will perish when ravaged femininity no longer sustains it, only then will we know what it is to be free." Betty Friedan wrote, "Young men protesting were defying the masculine mystique, as we had defied the feminine one." Robin Morgan wrote, "I feel that man-hating is an honorable and viable political act, that the oppressed have a right to class hatred against the class that is oppressing them."
I think that God made us of two different kinds, and the feminist movement really starts from the assumption that God goofed and they're trying to remedy his mistake. I think that would be a pity, because it is more fun having people in two different kinds.
Liberals don't mind feminine as long as it's only a present in males. Masculine, I don't think they ever like.
No more dying in back alleys. We'll keep marching in the rally.
Women must be freed from the yoke of pregnancy. Heck, it's just a simple matter of a woman's health. Abortion has no consequences.
We're here to say to Barbara Bush, we wish you had abstained. We march for women's rights. Kill it! Why give your baby to a moral couple?
Wesley Clark said, "Life begins with the mother's decision." Ingrid Newkirk wrote, "I don't believe human beings have a right to life. That's a supremacist perversion. A rat is a pig, is a dog, is a boy. Peter Singer stated, killing a disabled infant is not morally equivalent to killing a person. Very often, it is not wrong at all.
It really annoys me, this perception out there that women are overwhelmingly, you know, for killing babies. To the contrary, no matter who takes the poll and where the numbers are generally, whether it's NARAL or, you know, National Right to Life, women oppose abortion more than men do. Men do have, you know, a self-interest in abortion. And no matter who takes the poll, men support abortion more than women do. So this, you know, march for women's lives.
Okay. People constantly talk about the health of the mother. The Guttmacher Institute, which is a pro-abortion institute, did a survey on the reasons of women had abortions. They talked to women who had abortions. And it turned out that at least 90% of abortions have nothing to do with medical reasons, have nothing to do with health. And the remaining 10% didn't have much to do with it. It's now a birth control procedure.
Ronald Reagan wrote, "Simple morality dictates that unless and until someone can prove the unborn human is not alive, we must give it the benefit of the doubt and assume it is. And thus, it should be entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness."
But of course, it all had consequences. During the 60s and 70s, the sex, drugs, and rock and roll lifestyle championed by the left gave America abortion and welfare. It also gave America record levels of drug abuse, teenage pregnancy, and sexually transmitted diseases. It devastated American families, emptied churches and synagogues, and drove crime to record levels. Some socialists came to see the error of their ways. Others clung to their sacred illusions. But leftist professors didn't have to get dirty dealing with any consequences. They were well cared for in their ivory towers.
New Harmony represented the early age of socialism, what Marx would later call unscientific socialism. And while Karl Marx and other socialists failed to learn the two great lessons of New Harmony, they did draw one obvious conclusion. Socialism doesn't work when it's voluntary. And so in the 20th century, when the religion of socialism was ascendant, forced socialism was frequently the rule. Socialist movements destroyed churches, seized property, built networks of informants, and elaborate police states. To their movements flocked a dangerous mix of followers.
Under the leadership of Chairman Mao and the Chinese Communist Party, under the guidance of the general line for socialist construction of the party to strive hard and strive to advance, and to get greater, faster, better, and more economical results, and under the three great movements of class struggle, production struggle, and scientific testing, our Chinese people have achieved great successes.
Idealists convinced that destroying the world as it was would create a new heaven on earth. Hangers-on willing to say or do anything to reach the halls of power, and megalomaniacs eager to seize power in a new form of government, the totalitarian state, and legions of duped foot soldiers willing to destroy any institution or kill any enemy in the name of the new faith. Is the ultra-left all one vast, centrally directed conspiracy? Does some one group or some one person give orders to everyone in the ultra-left? Nope, it's not that simple. Most ultra-left groups are substantially independent of each other. They are best understood as a movement rather than a single organization. Often ultra-left leaders are personal rivals of each other. Many hope to grab all power individually for themselves if and when they overthrow our culture. Meanwhile, of course, they often cooperate in simultaneous projects to undermine ordered liberty in our society.
At an extraordinary session of the United Nations, Khrushchev continued his boisterous, boorish tactics.
For the better part of the 20th century, socialists had their way. Lenin, Hitler, Stalin, Mao, Saddam, the great murderers of history, all killing in the name of the common good.
Solve all problems. Give the left all power.
Vladimir Lenin wrote, "Our task is to utilize every manifestation of discontent and to gather and turn to the best account every protest, however small. Concentrate all droplets of popular resentment. Combine all these streamlets into a single gigantic torrent." Arthur Schlesinger Jr. wrote, "There seems no inherent obstacle to the gradual advance of socialism in the United States through a series of New Deals." Michael Moore said, "These bastards who run our country are a bunch of conniving, thieving, smug pricks who need to be brought down and removed and replaced with a whole new system that we control."
American radicals have a large quotient of nihilism. They mean that they can't agree on a program. There's no communist manifesto. There's no blueprint for the future. There's no, 10-point program of the left. This is what we're going to do when we get power. So that means that their entire energy, a revolution, it begins with a destruction. You have to destroy the existing order, then you build a new one. They have no ideas about building a new one. They don't spend very much time on it, and you couldn't find that many articles about it even. So all of their energy is the energy of destruction, and that makes them nihilists.
I used to ask them, what comes next? What is it you want to implement? What is it you want to do into the society? And their answer was, the society was so bad that they couldn't even rationally just think about what came next, because this society had to be destroyed, and then we would find out what came next.
While experiments in voluntary socialism had failed quickly and repeatedly, forced socialism had staying power.
Seht euch zum ersten Mal Deutschland!
Vast police forces, informants, forced labor camps, all made sure that individuals did exactly as they were told.
Camp out liberty! It's unfair!
Karl Marx wrote, "The meaning of peace is the absence of opposition to socialism." Bill Clinton said, "If the personal freedoms guaranteed by the Constitution inhibit the government's ability to govern the people, we should look to limit those guarantees."
Modern liberals are socialists. They're not liberals. What are they liberal about except hard drugs and sex? Everything else, they want to control your life. This is true of the Democratic Party. It's true of the British Labor Party. They're socialists, and that's their religion.
Socialist governments suppressed religion. They transformed schools into vehicles of political indoctrination. They banned the private ownership of guns. Art served the state. Sports served the state. Work served the state. Individual will was relentlessly punished.
Everything not compulsory must be prohibited.
Bill Clinton said, "We can't be so fixated on our desire to preserve the rights of ordinary Americans." Oliver Wendell Holmes wrote, "When it comes to the development of a corpus juris, the ultimate question is, what do the dominant forces of the community want? And do they want it hard enough to disregard whatever inhibitions may stand in the way?"
Human involvement in government throughout history has been the impulse to control, to exercise power over other people. The great miracle of the American experiment was the creation of a limited government, which we call a republic, and a government that respects the rights of individuals and understands that the real power and the real energy in a society doesn't ever generate out of government, that it generates out of the hearts and minds of free people willing to take chances, to risk their own resources, and it's been that model that's created the greatest and freest and wealthiest nation on the planet.
But the left never managed to eradicate individual will and desire. Human nature didn't allow it. And at the end of the 20th century, the socialist world began to crumble faster and faster. But that's a story you might not hear on American college campuses.
Rewrite history or stop teaching it.
Jesse Jackson chanted, "Hey, hey, ho, ho, Western Civ has got to go." Michael Moore said, There is no terrorist threat in this country. This is a lie. This is the biggest lie we've ever been told. Chester Pierce wrote, "Every child in America entering school at the age of five is insane because he comes to school with certain allegiances toward our founding fathers, toward his parents, toward our elected officials, toward a belief in a supernatural being, and toward the sovereignty of this nation as a separate entity. It's up to you, teachers, to make all these sick children well by creating the international child of the future."
There is, however, on American campuses, a very hard left on the faculties, which is teaching intellectual garbage and communist propaganda. I can't put it any other way. Howard Zinn has written the most popular history book of our time. It's called The People's History of America. It sold 1 million hardback copies, I think, or at least 1 million copies. It is a Stalinist cartoon. It is the protocols of the Elders of Zion with America standing in for the Jews. It is intellectually completely unrespectable, but it is taught. And in fact, he was just honored by the Organization of American Historians, which is run by a bunch of Marxists like Eric Foner and David Montgomery. The leadership of the organization, both professional associations, is far left, despise America, and rewrite history in a fashion to denigrate it, Western European history and American history, as a history of oppression, which we need to be liberated from. That's the old Marxist song.
The odd fact is that while socialism has been discredited around the world, the one safe place for socialists to hide has been college faculties. And if recent studies are correct, they're not interested in sharing space with those who were right all along.
Clean campuses, conservative-free zones!
Yeah, go back to your flat. I'm not in a frat. Go back to your George Bush mentality. Take it elsewhere. You don't want to hear it here.
Joseph Stalin wrote, "Ideas are more powerful than guns. We would not let our enemies have guns. Why should we let them have ideas?" Robert Brandon said, "If, as John Stuart Mill said, stupid people are generally conservative, then there are lots of conservatives we will never hire."
Universities are a left-wing monolith these days. A conservative professor or Republican or evangelical Christian professor is as rare as a unicorn.
Okay, another chant. Horowitz, racist ideologue. Capitalism's running dog.
Horowitz, racist ideologue. Capitalism's running dog.
The left came and got their PhDs in the 60s. Left got their PhDs in the 70s, became tenured professors and shut the doors behind them. So there has been an effective ideological cleansing of the universities.
Thomas Sowell wrote, "The most fundamental fact about the ideas of the political left is that they do not work. Therefore, we should not be surprised to find the left concentrated in institutions where ideas do not have to work in order to survive."
Fact of the matter is there is a discouragement of conservatives from applying for academic jobs, but it has nothing to do with alternative employment. It has to do with the fact that conservative students are abused from the time that they're freshmen and made to understand that the university is an entirely hostile environment to conservative ideas, and therefore they should have their heads examined before they attempt to pursue an academic career, since they will be thwarted at every point.
"The only way black people can get reparations for the hideous brutality of slavery is through the expropriation of the capitalist class."
When I was teaching at the Yale Law School, at one point, they found themselves with two Republican professors on the law school faculty, and another faculty member said, deliberately so that I would overhear, that it was the shame of the law school that we had two Republicans and no other department had any.
Dan Flynn is the author of two books on liberalism, Why the Left Hates America, and his latest release, Intellectual Morons.
Let me answer your question.
And let me get to what he brought up.
He often promotes his books by lecturing on college campuses, which are widely viewed as breeding grounds for the free discussion of ideas. Or are they?
Mumia Abu-Jamal was serving as his own lawyer, and he agreed. He agreed to the jury that was given him.
He picked his own jury.
I have had some pretty awful experiences on a number of elite college campuses in this country. At Berkeley, even before I took the podium, I was shouted down. I was mooned in the subject of a book burning. In the year 1998 at Columbia, I put on a conference there, and on the second day of the conference, we were kicked out, and we were forced to hold the event in a public park.
And in the media, all those new conservative voices have the left hopping mad.
In the media, any conservatives are too many.
Al Franken said, "I'd be glad if their shows were shut down. They lie, and they cheat, and they bully, and certainly I don't like it." Ed Asner said, "Hannity's next. We're going after him, just like we went after Limbaugh." Walter Cronkite said, "I think most newspapermen by definition have to be liberal. If they're not liberal, by any definition of it, they can hardly be good newspapermen." Igor Gaidar said, "The Soviets spent millions infiltrating your media. Just because the Soviet Union collapsed doesn't mean these people all went away."
The Pew Research Center's 2004 study of national press organizations found that there were 34% of the media that identified themselves as liberals and only 7% that identified themselves as conservatives. In 1992, of course, the Freedom Forum poll found that Bill Clinton got something like 90% of the vote from the Washington Press Corps. So the results are in, the numbers are overwhelming. The press is liberal.
Thomas Sowell wrote, "Sometimes the Fourth Estate seems like a fifth column."
Speech codes, hate speech laws. The modern left talks the talk of tolerance and diversity, but walks the walk of the totalitarian socialists of the past.
No free speech for conservatives!
Noam Chomsky wrote, "We have to ask ourselves if what is needed in the United States is dissent or denazification. To me, it seems that what is needed is denazification." The Washington Post reported, "A student court at Penn State told the Young Americans for Freedom chapter that its reference to human rights as God-given constituted religious discrimination."
There's always a hostility towards those who advocate the moral high ground, the moral compass, that those that believe that there is a right, that there is a wrong, those that believe that there's no such thing as same-sex marriage, it's an abomination to God, those that believe that you should preserve yourself until marriage before you have sex, and you should be committed to your marriage while you're married, because it can only bring about problems. So when you emphasize the high moral standard, people resist it because people don't want to restrain their behavior. They want the mentality of, if it feels good, then I can do it.
We're seeing in the movement for things like hate speech and hate crimes, the denigration of individual freedom to disagree on these issues. In Canada, already, a pastor has been indicted for putting an ad in the paper reciting biblical verse about homosexuality. And the same thing, I think, has taken place in Sweden. So around the world, liberals are beginning to suppress speech that they don't like as hate speech. I think we're on the verge of that here.
David Brooks stated, "The most common advice conservative students get is to keep their views in the closet."
Exhibit A, Identity Politics. Individuals don't have rights, only groups, the common good, matter. Al Sharpton said, "We don't owe America anything. America owes us." Hillary Clinton said, "We must stop thinking of the individual and start thinking about what is best for society."
Identity politics are just a means to an end. The end is the destruction of the United States of America.
America today historical black institutions, separate white institution, Asian studies, Hispanic studies, makes it seem as though we're balkanized Americans, that we don't have the same value system, as if we have different countries in America. But America's a melting pot. It's a nation of immigrants. That's what separates it and makes it great.
I noticed that the identity politics of, you know, black rights kind of falls apart when it comes to Condoleezza Rice and Colin Powell and Clarence Thomas. Now, doesn't it?
Exhibit B, gun control. Armed individuals make for bad cogs in the socialist machine, and it's a lot harder to make an armed man go along with your idea of the common good.
Give up your guns! We want you defenseless!
I don't think that you or I should, unless there is absolutely some very important reason, it's beyond my ken to think about. I don't think the average person should have a gun, and I don't think concealed weapons should be allowed.
Vladimir Lenin wrote, "A system of licensing and registration is the perfect device to deny gun ownership to the bourgeoisie." Congressman Henry Waxman stated, "If someone is so fearful that they're going to start using their weapons to protect their rights, it makes me very nervous that these people have these weapons at all." Senator Joe Biden said, "Banning guns is an idea whose time has come." Janet Reno said, "Waiting periods are only a step. Registration is only a step. The prohibition of private firearms is the goal."
I think we had our druthers, it would be like England or Australia or other civilized countries. And Australia is a country much like ours that has, you know, a wild west and sort of a wild history. And they've taken all these weapons out of individual hands, and so have the British, and it makes sense.
Gun control is a complete failure. And if you don't believe me, come to the city where I live, the nation's capital. I was in the Marine Reserves for 8 years, and yet I cannot legally possess a firearm in the city where I live. What gun control does is take guns out of the hands of law-abiding people like myself, and criminals who, by definition, don't obey laws, well, they have all the guns that they want.
Thomas Jefferson wrote, "Laws that forbid the carrying of arms disarm only those who are neither inclined nor determined to commit crimes. Such laws make things worse for the assaulted and better for the assailants." James Madison wrote, "Americans have the right and advantage of being armed, unlike the citizens of other countries whose governments are afraid to trust the people with arms."
We are the Union!
We are the Union!
Mighty, mighty Union!
Mighty, mighty Union!
Exhibit C, forget what you or any individual wants. Join the Union or else.
Pay the Union bus, or we'll crack your skull.
The Philadelphia Inquirer reported, "We're going to blow your head off. Where's your wife? Where's your children?" the picket shouted. Unnamed Union picketer quoted in the Washington Post, "Violence is necessary. The only people that really don't come back are the people that have gotten beaten up." Richard Trumka said, "Our message is that unions are back. Get in our way and we'll knock you flat on your ass."
If unions had free rein in our society under the current structure, it would be detrimental to our society and detrimental to our culture. As a matter of fact, the evidence is clear now that that's the case. Unions adhere to the institution of compulsion to gather members and political strength, and we know that system can't stand.
What do we want? Freedom! What do we want it now?
Exhibit D. If individual rights or private property get in the way of the environment, individual rights and private property no longer matter.
Save the environment! Kill off all the people!
John Davis wrote, "Human beings, as a species, have no more value than slugs." I suspect that eradicating smallpox was wrong. It played an important part in balancing ecosystems. David Foreman said, "We must make this an insecure and inhospitable place for capitalists and their projects. We must reclaim the roads and plowed land, halt dam constructions, tear down existing dams, free shackled rivers, and return to wilderness millions of tens of millions of acres of presently settled land." Italian leftist at the Instituto Bruno Leoni, "You want the poor countries to develop, but we actually need the poor to stay poor. If they develop too, Earth's environment will collapse." Ingrid Newkirk stated, even if animal tests produced a cure for AIDS, we'd be against it.
Many of these people are earth worshippers. They think that the word earth is sacrosanct and human beings are evil. And even more important than that, than a quote like that, is that these people are engaging in policy that do in fact kill people, like banning DDT use and malaria is up all over the world as a result of that. At one time it was down when DDT was being used in many countries, but the left, motivated by Rachel Carson's book, The Silent Spring, and worried about what the DDT is doing to the environment, and I think that the alarmist concerns is not doing that much if it's properly used, they're causing the killing of millions and millions of people. They're not very compassionate at all.
Exhibit E. Forget what kind of education you want for your child. We know what your kid needs to learn, and we'll do the teaching.
Education.
Joseph Stalin wrote, "State-controlled education is a weapon whose effect depends on who holds it in his hands and at whom it is aimed." Ralph Neese stated, "School vouchers aren't about improving education or offering choice. They are a calculated strategy to move resources out of public schools."
That is sheer lunacy to think that we could ever get rid of private schools, vouchers, magnet schools, because the reasons why they exist is because of the failings of public schools. Public schools have failed their mission. It's one of the reasons why many minorities drop out of high school at an alarming rate.
That's the way schools are in communist countries. The government runs all the schools. And I don't think we want that. We want a lot of diversity and competition among schools. And America's very fortunate that we have many fine private and religious schools. And it would be absolutely a violation of everything we believe in to get rid of them.
Public education needs to emulate what private education is doing, because it would make it far better.
You can't break our union down.
You can't break our union down.
Take our advice, get out of town.
And when a child's education gets in the way of the union's common good, well, too bad for the kids.
More important than teaching kids.
Albert Schenker said, "When school children start paying union dues, that's when I'll start representing the interests of school children." Written in the National Education Association handbook, the National Education Association denounces the practice of keeping schools open during a strike.
Teachers' unions, in all fairness, like every union in America, are an employee-based collective bargaining organization. They exist for the benefit of their members. And the last time I checked, there's not a single student who's a dues-paying member of the National Education Association or any state teachers' union in America.
Teachers' unions are only concerned about union dues, memberships, fees. Their bottom line is to have as many kids in that classroom as possible to put more money in their coffers. They could care less if that child gets an education or not. That's why vouchers, competition is very important to hold these unions and these schools accountable for the lack of results in these kids in these classrooms.
The teachers' unions are not necessarily to be faulted for putting teachers' wages and pay scales and working hours over the object of education, which is educating the next generation of Americans. But I have to tell you, it's frustrating for me when, in advancing the interest of their membership in terms of secure employment, the teachers' union has stood in the way, stood in the schoolhouse door, to prevent entire generations of Americans to escape failing schools in our inner cities. And fortunately, we're starting to change that.
It would all just be the give and take of politics, with an important safeguard, the U.S. Constitution. Our founding document guarantees the rights of individuals, but it can only protect those rights as long as judges enforce its provisions.
The judges give us what we want. Forget the laws and the Constitution.
Senator J. William Fulbright said, "The case for government by elites is irrefutable. Government by the people is possible, but highly improbable." William Brennan wrote, "The genius of the Constitution rests not in any static meaning it might have had in a world that is dead and gone, but in the adaptability of its great principles to cope with current problems and current needs." Stephen Breyer wrote, I meant that the extent to which the Constitution is flexible is a function of what provisions you're talking about. You realize that the framers intended those words to maintain constant values that would change in their application as society changed.
The judicial branch is now carrying out what you might call a culturally left-wing agenda by distorting the Constitution completely. And I think the most egregious example, of course, was the abortion decision. Now, however one feels about abortion, there's nothing about it in the Constitution, pro or con. But the judges of the Supreme Court seized upon it and wrote an abortion law.
It is a dangerous thing what the court has been doing for 20 years now. Liberals keep cheering it on because they like what the decisions are. But it's a big problem when you give up your right to govern yourself in a democracy. If the Constitution says nothing about it, it's supposed to be decided in the states by democracy, by people persuading their fellow voters, by compromise, by elections.
Of course, you know about the decision deciding that computer-simulated child pornography was protected free speech. They have chipped away at the death penalty, made it harder and harder to enforce, although there's no basis in the Constitution to do that. And they have shown a special regard for homosexuality, and I think we are on the verge of a Supreme Court decision making homosexual marriage a constitutional right. So they are changing the morality and the culture of the United States in what can only be called a leftist direction.
Thomas Sowell wrote, "One of the reasons courts at all levels get away with imposing judges' personal views as the law of the land is that so much of the public and the media view each decision in terms of whether they agree with the particular policy it represents. But the destruction of the separation of powers, which is central to the Constitution, is infinitely more important than whether policy A is better or worse than policy B. Letting judges change the law by verbal sleight of hand is dangerous in a country where the people are supposed to have the power to control the laws they live under via their elected representatives." George Will wrote, "The premise is that unjust and unconstitutional are synonyms."
After the failure of New Harmony, Robert Owen headed back to Britain. Being a socialist, he wasn't about to blame socialism for his failure. He told Europeans that it was Americans who failed, saying,
"I found the population of the states far too undeveloped at that period for the practice of a full and true social life."
For the next century and a half, socialists pointed the finger of blame at America. They resented America's vitality as their societies slipped into backwardness. They resented American prosperity as they created economic basket cases. And most of all, they resented the notion of a nation based on individual liberty. For those who embraced the cult of the common good, America always stood in the way.
And voting to impeach, and we shall live in peace.
An anti-war rally in 2004, but it could just as easily be 1969, or 1939, or 1889. Anywhere the ultra-left gathers, America is the enemy. Its devotion to individual rights and freedom, the biggest threat to a socialist future. Unfortunately, the course of utopians of the left skillfully recruit many vulnerable and idealistic young people and radicalize them against their country and our culture.
America causes all world problems.
Noam Chomsky stated, "We should not forget that the U.S. itself is a leading terrorist state."
The United States is, you know, the biggest example. Hell, we're in the belly of the beast right here. I mean, you know, Bush is, you know, and all his corporate friends are using their power, you know, when the friends of the CIA and the friends of the FBI and the friends in the counterintelligence agencies to forge evidence, manipulate the media to, you know, impact fear and security onto people so that, you know, they just willingly believe and, you know, mindlessly, you know, what the state tells them. And that's what allows such atrocities like the war on Iraq or Afghanistan or Vietnam or Cambodia or any of the, you know, hundreds of operations we've had around the world. They're all just, you know, all these wars and all this stuff is just a way for the rich ruling classes to, you know, profit off of exploitation of workers worldwide.
Since the collapse of the Soviet Union has been one of U.S. empire, has been one of, openly with the Bush doctrine now, of admitting that we want to be the hegemonic superpower of the world. And that means not only screwing over the world, I mean, if we remember the axis of evil, Bush has a plan laid out for remaking the Middle East, and the only thing stopping that is the Iraqi resistance.
Fidel Castro said, "So there exists an enemy who can be called universal. And if there ever was in the history of humanity an enemy whose acts and moves troubled the entire world, threaten the entire world, attack the entire world in one way or another, that real and really universal enemy is precisely Yankee imperialism." Professor Nikki DeGeneva stated, "The only true heroes are those who find ways that help defeat the U.S. military. I personally would like to see 1 million Mogadishus."
I think America is in trouble when Europeans don't hate us. They sure hated Ronald Reagan. Boy, they hated Ronald Reagan a lot. Every time he had a trip over there, there were huge, you know, mass protests, the Greens in Germany. Oh, he's the most hated president.
Being on the left is not being rational. You have this vision of the redeemed future. You think there's a pot of gold over the rainbow. You think there's a heaven that could be built on earth, and the United States is opposing it. So everything that's good in America is really bad, because it's confusing people and bribing them to support a system which makes so many other people miserable. That's the way the left sees the world.
As Reagan is winning the Cold War, you know, the New York Times is constantly finding European diplomats to talk about what a disaster he's making and sniffing at them and, oh, overheard at a Georgetown cocktail party. Well, okay. Yeah, and then he defeated a 50-year-old evil regime.
Who's to blame? For the left, the stock answer is always America. And we saw this in its most extreme form after 9/11, when students, professors, and administrators were saying we had it coming, that 9/11 was just the chickens coming home to roost. The ugliest example of this, and the most famous example, is probably Noam Chomsky, who is a central figure on the American left today.
Seine Söhne in euch marschieren sehen.
And America has fought and bled to stop the spread of socialism against socialists in Germany, in the Soviet Union, in Korea, in Vietnam. It's the reason socialists hate the Stars and Stripes.
Eliminate patriotism.
This flag was made by a magazine called Adbusters, and pretty much it's just the American flag with the stars replaced by corporate logos, like symbolizing the amount of power that the corporations have on our government.
George Bernard Shaw wrote, "You'll never have a quiet world till you knock the patriotism out of the human race." Norman Mailer said, "America has an almost obscene infatuation with itself. Has there ever been a big, powerful country that is as patriotic as America? And patriotic in the tiniest way, with so much flag waving." Janine Garofalo said, "Our country is founded on a sham. Our forefathers were slave-owning rich white guys who wanted it their way. So when I see the American flag, I go, oh my God, you're insulting me." That you can have a gay parade on Christopher Street in New York with naked men and women cheering, "We're here, we're queer." That's what makes my heart swell. Not the flag, but a gay naked man or woman burning the flag. I get choked up with pride. Tom Brokaw said, "I don't think a journalist ought to be wearing a flag, because it does seem to be, to me at least, a sign of solidarity toward whatever the government is doing, and that is not our role."
If you're in the left, it's always about the oppressor and the oppressed, the victim and the victimizer and the victim, the dominator and the subjected. That's the vision, that's the prism. Everything is seen through that. So in the world, in the global system, they like to call globalization, is America at the top, America as the guardian of private property, which is the root of all evil. And they hate America. And so all the symbols of the nation, that inspire people to want to protect the nation, like the flag, are hateful symbols to them.
Patriotism has become a divisive term today because of the Michael Moores and the Sean Penns and the Tim Robbins and the Barbara Streisands and all the Blame America First crowd. But patriotism is still a good thing. It inspires. It doesn't dampen the spirit of our citizens. And the left, which all too frequently voices animus for this great land, the left is wrong.
To those who still cling to the cult of the common good, America has to be shackled. International bureaucrats must win the day.
Bill Clinton said, "There are a lot of very brilliant people who believe that the nation-state is fast becoming a relic of the past." Walter Cronkite stated, "It seems to many of us that if we are to avoid the eventual catastrophic world conflict, we must strengthen the United Nations as a first step toward a world government, patterned after our own government, with a legislature, executive, and judiciary, and police to enforce its international laws and keep the peace. To do that, of course, we Americans will have to yield up some of our sovereignty. That would be a bitter pill. It would take a lot of courage, a lot of faith in the new order." John Kerry stated, "I'm an internationalist. I'd like to see our troops dispersed through the world only at the directive of the United Nations." Strobe Talbot stated, "In the next century, nations as we know it will be obsolete. All states will recognize a single global authority. National sovereignty wasn't such a great idea after all."
The UN is completely corrupt, and we certainly do not want the UN to invade our sovereignty by having anything to say about the deployment of American troops or about our policies abroad.
Jesse Helms wrote, "Should the UN become a burden because it fails to respect the sovereign rights of the American people would cast it aside." Ronald Reagan said, "The top priority of the federal government is the safety of this country."
A wise man once said that insanity is the stubborn determination to keep doing the same thing over and over, but expecting to get different results. Call it naive, call it dishonest, call it ignorant. Maybe they think it will work. Maybe they just like the idea of telling other people what to do. Whatever the reasoning, those who worship at the altar of the common good never seem to learn a lesson.
Next time, Marxist-Leninists will get it right.
R is for revolution, E is for everybody, S, support the system, I, ignite debate, S, smash the state, D, tear it down. Resist, resist, raise up your fist.
We believe in power back to the people. We're supporting the workers of the world in their fight against the oppression of this extreme capitalism.
Jane Fonda said, "I would think that if you understood what communism was, you would hope, you would pray on your knees, that we would someday become communists." Sam Marcy wrote, "The very success of capitalism in vastly expanding the means of production through ruthlessly restructuring will disrupt the present economic patterns and lay bare the most important contradiction of capitalism. That contradiction is between the socialized character of the production process and the individual, really corporate, ownership of the basic means of production. A momentous era is fast approaching. It will not only influence U.S. history, but will have far-reaching effects throughout the world."
It wasn't a mistake. It was the logical Soviet totalitarianism is the logical extension of Marxist ideas.
People who are promoting socialism and communism, they are duty-bound to say, here's where it works. They shouldn't give us any theory in saying, it hasn't been really tried, and et cetera, et cetera. They have to say, here's where it works. Because I can surely point to the successes and say, mankind is richest under capitalism, and I can give you many, many examples. The socialists in our country and around the world, they cannot point to a single case of a socialistic success. Even in countries like Sweden, it's increasingly becoming a basket case, and they're trying to move away from
socialism and all of its promises that never panned out.
There was a funny story about Professor Susan Buck Morse at Cornell. And she herself, I mean, she wasn't even embarrassed by this story. All these American scholars were going over to the old Soviet Union soon after it crumbled. And she's giving a lecture to them, and she cites Marx favorably, of course, and all the Soviet, you know, former Soviet Union, Russian scholars in the room started laughing because they just assumed, you know, this woman is citing Marx, this has to be a joke. And no, she was citing Marx favorably, and she wasn't even embarrassed by this story.
Marx is a crackpot, and the only thing you can say in his behalf is that he didn't live to see the 100 million people killed by his and the billions made poor by his crackpot theories. But today's leftists saw that, and they're going on with it. So how can you have any respect for them?
We finish with another story, an old story, the oldest, in fact, a man and a woman in paradise. All their needs met, food, safety, love. And to them comes a serpent. Forget what you have, he tells them. Forget the abundance around you, for I can deliver you more. I can show you heaven. I can make you gods. Many believe that story was given by God. Others say it's the collected wisdom of thousands of years of mankind. Either way, it's a lesson always to be heeded. Beware those who promise you heaven on earth. Beware those who say they can perfect mankind. Beware those anxious to tear down everything, promising to build paradise in its wake. Here's conservative thought in a nutshell. Learn from the past. Build on what works, not on visions of utopia. Celebrate man's better tendencies, but always beware his dark side. Equality, brotherhood, the common good, the new man. They're seductive arguments, and they've won followers on the left for two centuries. Only a clear understanding of what these ideas really mean can protect society from disaster. That means education and activism. That means more people speaking up for limited government, free enterprise, strong national defense, and traditional family moral values. That means demanding that politicians repudiate radicals in our midst. That means studying how to win.
We have seen the roots of the ultra-left, what they really think. They harness hate and envy in their quest for unlimited power. They think that if they grab all power, they can abolish human nature and create a utopia of their dreams. Usually, it's easy to figure out which candidates the ultra-left wants to win an election. Wise conservatives work hard to elect candidates who reject the ultra-left. If you'd like to help fight the ultra-left on campus, the Leadership Institute's Campus Leadership Program stands ready to help any conservative student build an effective conservative group on any campus. The Campus Leadership Program already has helped form more than 200 active independent student groups on campuses in 42 states. At www.leadershipinstitute.org, you'll find the script of this video, supplemental materials, and Read to Lead, a list and descriptions of dozens of books and periodicals which will deepen your understanding of the ultra-left and how to make a difference for conservative principles. You'll also find there links to other resources for campus conservatives, including Accuracy in Academia, American Collegians for Life, CFACT, Claire Booth Luce Institute, Collegiate Eagle Forum, Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, Fund for American Studies, Intercollegiate Studies Institute, Students for Academic Freedom, and Young America's Foundation. Thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this presentation and that it empowers you to make a difference for yourself and for your country.
We're here to say to Barbara, resist.
The enemy is profit,
disease,
and starvation will not be solved by corporations.
We believe that socialism is the only sane alternative to capitalism.
Bombs are dropping!
While you're shopping!
Bombs are dropping!